Dark Souls is a game that is legendary for its difficulty, but what if I told you it's not actually that hard? What if I told you that Dark Souls is actually so easy you can beat it at Soul Level 1 without breaking a sweat? Well, that's what I'm going to show you today. How to beat Dark Souls at Soul Level 1, but as the ultimate life form. This run starts off the same as any other Soul Level 1 run: pick Pyromancer and take the Master Key. While I'm doing my prison rounds, let me quickly go over the rules. Stay at Soul Level 1, kill all bosses, and become as powerful as possible. I'm also going to allow two glitches, but I'll explain that when I come to it. Oh, looks like we're done with tutorial jail, so let's get to the actual run. Okay, so all in all, we're going to need 9 core items. 3 of them are available right as we get to Firelink, and the other 5 with minimal effort. The final item is locked behind several bosses, but I'm getting ahead of myself. First, we need to make our way over to the merchant in the Undead Burg and buy 2 things: the Residence Key and the Reinforced Club, the latter of which is the first on our checklist. This club is going to be our backup weapon for several fights, but that's something for future me to explain. For now, we do the first of our 2 glitches, Undead Burg Skip. After you climb this ladder, you're able to roll to this little balcony, then jump over the railing to access lower Undead Burg without fighting the Taurus Demon. At this point, all I wanted to do was open the shortcut so I could easily get here later. And the only reason I wanted to do this at all is so I could fight the Taurus Demon at full power. Next, we head towards the Valley of Drakes for our second item, the Red Steroid Ring. Alright, just gotta land and run away from these dragons and... yep, nailed it. Anyway, we grab the Grass Crest Shield as it'll be our main shield for quite a while, then we make our way up to grab the guaranteed Titanite Shard, then use the souls we picked up from the Valley of Drakes to buy a few more to make our club a +4. With this, I feel a little more comfortable fighting the two bosses I need to kill before reaching full power, the first of which is up next. We make our way back through the Undead Burg, through the previously opened shortcut, suddenly become directionally challenged, free Griggs of Vinheim for later, then take the fight to the Capper Demon. The Goat Man himself isn't so hard, but these dogs are just awful. Like, who thought it was a good idea? Whatever, I got lucky and didn't get wombo comboed by them and was able to kill the Capper Demon first try. The reason why I needed to kill him now, before becoming stupidly overpowered, was because his death grants us the key to the depths, allowing us access to Laurentius, and Laurentius is one of the keys to this run. Since we're so close to him, I decided to just go free him now, then forget how to answer his questions because half the NPCs in this game speak in negatives. Either way, we buy combustion for a little extra firepower. Get it? Firepower? Then we level up our flame to a +3 before heading back to Andre to use our remaining souls to make our club a +5, and head to everyone's favorite swamp, Blighttown. The swampland actually contains several key items for us, as well as the second boss before we ascend, Quelaag. I'm not mad. I'm just disappointed. Unfortunately, Spider Bay over here is completely immune to fire damage. Fortunately, she's not immune to the Ungabunga, and she's pretty easy to fight. Unless she shoots lava at a 90 degree angle. But seriously, all of her attacks are well telegraphed, and after a few dozen bonks, she goes down. I went to talk to Quelana, but I accidentally gave the wrong answer to Igni. I could have become infested with an egg to fix the issue, but murder was quicker. Pledging allegiance to the True Lady, we homeward bone out and make our way back to Firelink, where we make absolutely sure not to tell Laurentius where we got the Chaos Pyromancy, as if we did, this run would be dead in the water. Or dead in the swamp, I guess. Next, we head back to the depths to pick up the large ember to give our club a little bit more oomph. I really did try to make it back to Firelink without dying, but the game had other plans for me, I guess. That's fine, because now we're going to perform our second glitch, Soul Duplication. Now, I know what you're thinking. How can you use a soul duplication glitch in a challenge run? Well, the short answer is, we need souls. And a lot of them. To be more exact, we're going to need roughly 350,000 souls. Of course, it's possible to farm enemies to get to that number legitimately, but to be honest, I didn't want to stream me killing the same group of enemies over and over for 8 hours. At any rate, we dupe Quelaag's soul until we have enough to make our flame a +15, then head over to Darkroot Basin to grab a couple more key items, the Dusk Crown Ring from the Hydra, and the Crown of Dusk from, well, Dusk. That brings our total up to 4 items. Next is a return trip to Blighttown for basically the final setup before we reach maximum power. The first thing we do is dupe some more souls, then buy Great Combustion, our damage dealer for 95% of the run, then enhance our Pyromancy Flame and take it to a +5. After that, we ascend the rafters to grab... well, that's unfortunate. No matter, we make our way up again and... bro, seriously? This time I bait out its attacks and grab Power Within. We make our way over to the Great Hollow so we can die. No, I'm serious. We need to actually die here. More specifically, we need to be cursed. I'll explain why a little later. For now, just roll with it. After that, we head back to Firelink, dupe our souls one more time, and buy the bellowing Dragoncrest ring from Griggs. And with that, the setup is complete. Well, almost. There is one more item to get, but like I said, it's locked behind several bosses, and it's not necessary for damage, but I'll explain its purpose when we get there. I'm sure you've all figured out my plan by now, but let me explain. Essentially, I'm gonna stack as many damaging buffs on top of each other to become an absolute unit. The red steroid ring increases damage by 50% when you're below 20% of your current maximum HP, power within increases all damage by 40% while it's active, the dust crown increases magic damage, including pyromancy, by 20%, and the bellowing dragon crest ring also increases pyromancy by 20%. Combine all this with a fully maxed out flame and great combustion, and you have a lot of damage, especially considering I'm still soul level 1. It's by no means the most damage you can do in one hit. No, I think that award goes to Darkbead, but no class is able to use that sorcery without leveling up, so... Alright, enough math. Let's go test out our new power on a boss, the Taurus Demon. I'm just gonna play my live reaction to this fight. Alright, we're in Red Tearstone Ring, let's try it. Come here, you big stupid thing. Stupid. Okay. It's good damage. We do good damage. Oh, this is gonna be a fun run. Oh yeah. It's time for my reign of power to begin. Next, we head over to the gargoyles to show them who's boss. Again, I'll just let this fight play out. Don't worry, it won't take long. Even with our insane power, there are still a couple places I'm worried about. After all, we basically have no health for this run, but I'll worry about those when I come to it. For now, we go back to Firelink and... God damn it, Lautrec. Well, grab the Black Eye Orb, then head towards Sin's Funhouse, and... Wow, that might be the first time I've died to the Dart Trap since my first playthrough. Anyway, the Iron Golem is going to taste my true power and... Am I a joke to you, game? Second try, the Iron Golem gets melted in just 3 hits, and we're off to Anor-Londo. I went ahead and raised my club to a +8. I don't plan on using it soon, but might as well. The rafters are as terrifying as ever, because fire doesn't beat gravity, but it does beat the Painted Guardians. So next up are Pikachu and Snorlax. Honestly, I've never been so unafraid of this fight because...
They ask you how you are, you just have to say that you're fine.
These two aren't scary because literally anything they do will one-shot me. And just look at that damage, it only took 5 casts of Great Combustion total. Now that's pretty satisfying. Anyway, up to see the illusionary Booba Lady, grab the Lord Vessel and commit high treason. Wait, it's not what you think, I just need to murder her brother and can't be bothered to get a ring for it. Come here, snake boy, I'm gonna show you who's the real deity around here. I guess it's him. Come here, snake boy! And like that, Gwendolyn is dead. Let's also quickly avenge Anastasia and teach Lautrec not to murder firekeepers. Should have kicked him off the cliff when I had a chance, but whatever, he's dead now. With Anastasia revived, it's time to start working on killing the lords. First, I grab the crest of Artorias, then remember I actually hadn't killed the Moonlight Butterfly yet. That fight goes as you'd expect. Next up is Lordran's best doggo, Sif. I was a little worried because Sif, like Quelaag, has hitboxes when she's jumping around. And with this little health, I thought it might be an issue, but... I can't believe people say this game is hard. At this point, I decide it's finally time to head over to the catacombs, which is the location of our final item. First up is Pinwheel, and this is gonna be an easy clap. He's weak to-
They ask you how you are, you just have to say that you're fine, and you're not really fine, but you just can't get in-
An easy clap, I said. The Mask of the Father. Why couldn't you drop that during my Sonic Cavil run? This is why nobody likes you, Pinwheel. Now, we just need to navigate the Tomb of the Giants without a light source. I've been here so many times, it's not really an issue, but this is where I learned something new that is an issue. See, the whole reason we are here is to fight Paladin Leroy. Paladin Leroy only spawns if you're human, and you can't turn into a human while cursed. Also, fun fact, Paladin Leroy also doesn't spawn if you haven't placed the Lord Vessel. Shout out to the backlogs for telling me that in a video just before I did this run, saved me a lot of time. Anyway, we need to uncurse ourselves to become human, so let's go buy some purging stones and do just that. Now Paladin Leroy will invade us. By the way, just a quick tip for a game that's 11 years old, if you want his items, do not knock him off the edge. They won't spawn. With that, we have our final item, the Sanctus Shield. Okay, this shield isn't going to increase our power, but it will help with survivability. Power Within drains 1% of our current maximum HP per second, and Sanctus heals us for 1 HP per second. In short, with both the Dustcrown ring on and being cursed, we're able to heal practically as fast as the life drain happens. The downside is that we can't swap the Dustcrown ring for the Bellowing Dragon Crest ring, as it would change my maximum HP to the point where the drain is greater than the regeneration. I didn't really end up using the shield as much as I thought I would, but it's nice to have for fights where I can only rely on Onga Bonga and not Great Combustion. Anyway, I didn't really want to do Nito just yet, so I decided to make my way over to the Duke's archives, making sure to grab the broken pendant for the DLC. I wanted to be cursed again, and I thought, ah, Cease Mandatory Death can curse me, and that's true, but I forgot his curse spikes also do damage, and yeah, I'm just an idiot. After navigating the library, I decided to head back to Firelink and make my way back to jail. Just gotta do my best impression of an egg. Works every time. I know the Stray Demon is weak to bleed, but using fire is just more fun. Four hits and Buff Boy bites it. Parry this, you casual. I grab the doll and the rusted iron ring, then make my way over to Great Hollow to be cursed again. Hey look, it's my dead body. Now that we're at half HP again, I decide to take on the Lava World, as it has one of the boss fights I'm worried about, and it's not the Bed of Chaos. First up is Ceaseless. Must be lactose intolerant because he dies to the cheese. Next up is the Demon Fire Sage, who apparently has a weakness to fire. Yep, I'd say pretty weak alright. But now we have one of two fights I was worried about in this run, the Centipede Demon. So here's the thing. The Centipede Demon himself isn't actually that big of an issue, it's just that 95% of his arena is covered in lava, and lava is bad for our health. This is what his arena looks like. Normally, I fight him over here on this patch of land. The issue is you have to cross a small amount of lava to get to it. Normally, not a problem. But for us, it's a big problem. So I have two options. Either one, fight him on this tiny strip of land, or two, somehow manage to cut off his tail or arm and pick up the orange charred ring that way. I did try my best to fight him here, even going so far as to attempt to use the corner cheese, but this dude really just likes to extendo fist me every chance he gets. Eventually, I did get lucky and managed to sever his arm and grab the ring. Now I have the ability to maneuver around the battlefield, but there's one other teeny tiny little issue. He's completely immune to fire damage. Let me tell you, I have never had this much trouble with this boss in my life. Not only does he have deceptively large hitboxes, but I also had to make sure I didn't accidentally dip my toe in the lava. This fight ended up taking more lives than anything else in this whole run. Eventually, I Onga Bunga'd my way to victory. Unfortunately, that victory was short-lived when I encountered my true enemy, more lava. So you remember that map of the Centipede's boss arena? Yeah, now imagine that, but more. I considered uncursing myself just for additional health, but in the end I found out that a well-timed Estus would allow me to cross this stupid lake. Normally, I don't do the quit-out cheese with the bed, but I made an exception this time. After a few more tries, the Bed of Chaos is dead. After all that lava, I decided to have a fair one-on-one fight with an immortal dragon, so it's off to the Crystal Cave to fight Seath. Come here, you big stupid dragon, break the only thing that could stop me from killing you. Idiot. I guess he's not so immortal after all. Alright. I've put it off long enough. It's time to make our way to the Four Kings. Honestly, I'm not worried about the actual fight. I mean, they have a weakness to fire. I'm more worried about the path to actually get to them. Specifically, the Ghost House. I hate this place. The number of ghosts is just too damn high, and the unavoidable one on the ladder really has me worried. I ended up luring most of the ghosts outside and hit them with fireballs to lower their numbers. What you're seeing now is the 6th or 7th attempt at this. I actually ran out of fireballs and had to beat a few of them to death. Or re-death, I guess. When the coast was clear, I put on my heaviest armor and climbed the ladder. We made it to the top, got the key, then opened that stupid gate. Now it's time for the actual fight. Unfortunately, we need to wear the Covenant of Artorias for this fight, meaning one of my ring slots is taken up. But no matter, I'm confident in my ability to actually win. Just like I thought, we absolutely shred the first king. But you might have noticed a problem. See, the kings spawn on a timer, one every 45 seconds to be exact. we don't exactly have 45 seconds to live. I thought about swapping the red tearstone ring with the dust crown ring, at least then we could have healed through power within without Estus, but I actually ended up being clipped by the king's hilts a couple of times and had just enough health to survive that. What I didn't anticipate was running out of great combustion gas. Again, something that could have been solved by using the dust crown ring. But in the end, the good old Ungabunga pulled us through and the four kings went down first try. At this point, the only lord left is Nito. And let me tell you, I am not in the slightest bit afraid of Nito. Not at all. If you put me and him into a cage match, I would absolutely curb stomp him. No, no, no. What I'm afraid of is his skeletons. And gravity. You see, for some reason, Frum thought it was a great idea to put the entrance to his arena in a hole that has unavoidable fall damage. Why they thought it was a good idea, I'll never know. Because it's not a good idea. It's a horrible idea. Of course, during a normal playthrough, this isn't that big an issue, just kind of an annoyance. But at Soul Level 1, it's a little more than that. It's actually possible to roll just before the cutscene and have it cancel the landing animation, and you better hope you do that, because if Nito's opening attack is the sword stab, then I hope you're good at sound cues. So what happens if you manage to get past that attack? Well, then you have three unkillable skeletons in your way. Again, during a normal playthrough, not really an issue. In fact, Nito can, and often will, take them out of the fight for you. Temporarily, of course. But I didn't want to waste any casts of Great Combustion on them. So what did I do? Well, you saw the giant asterisk show up on the screen when I said unkillable, right? Yeah, that's because they aren't actually unkillable. A divine-enhanced weapon will put them down for good. And wouldn't you know it, I just happened to have picked up an occult club in Anorlando earlier. It's almost like I planned for this. So, we take the club back to Andre, then demote it from occult to divine, and bam, skeleton bonker. Back to Nito, and a couple of attempts later, we clear out the skeletons, and then it's time for the good old one-on-one. Remember what I said about a cage match? Well, just call me the Undertaker, because Nito is dead. More dead. Whatever, I won. Hey, it's future editing Doomwolf here, so I am the giga stupid and forgot to hit record when I was streaming, so the only footage I have from here on is of my actual stream. Yeah, sorry about that. Okay, anyway, back to it. I'm running out of bosses to assert dominance on, so let's go to a boss that'll make me sad. We're off to the Painted World. Just like normal, we re-dead the undead dragon, touch the butt, and meet the true queen Priscilla. Fun fact, one of my followers banned me from healing while I was streaming. Do you see how this could be a problem? Well, no matter, I deserve this death for hurting Priscilla. Next, we make our way to the past. That's right, it's DLC time, baby! First up is the Sanctuary Guardian. Normally, not a tough fight, but well, I guess this time also not a tough fight either. Hopefully Artorias provides us more of a challenge? Well, I asked for it. Not gonna lie, I got extremely lucky with this Artorias fight. Not only did I dodge two attacks that I had no business dodging, but also got a lucky counter hit on them. But, as they say, we take those. This is where it dawned on me that I didn't have a way to get the silver pendant, meaning I'd have to fight Manus without the ability to deflect his magic. Oh boy, doesn't that just sound fun. It took a handful of attempts, half of which died within the first attack, but with some of that gamer focus, we were able to bring down the Father of the Abyss. After a quick trip to grab the crest key, it's off to fight us a dragon. Well, after we get a little help from old Hawkeye. You know, this gives me an idea for another challenge run. Anyway, it's time to square up against Calamite. Here, allow me to show you the moment my soul left my body. Oh crap. Doesn't matter.
Calamite! Calamite, please! Calamite, please! Fuck this dragon!
Believe it or not, it actually happened twice. Calamite must have leveled up ADP. I ended up going to get Black Flame on chat's recommendation, but pro tip, Calamite takes even less damage from it. Doesn't matter. After a few more attempts, I stand above the dragon in the food chain and shield pose on his body. With that, the DLC comes to a close, and now all that's left is to take on the Lord of Cinder himself. Oh god damn it! I forgot the Gaping Dragon again! This wasn't scripted, I actually just forgot about him. Whatever, through the depths, into the sewer, bonk the channeler, and he's dead. Now it's time for Gwyn. Not so fun fact, I have never been able to parry Gwyn's first hit, the jumping attack. Everyone tells you it's so easy, but I just can't do it. No matter how hard I try, he just smacks me down. So now is the time. Now is the time that I show Gwen how much more powerful I am to assert dominance on this lord. Gwen, I'm gonna get murdered. I'm gonna get murdered. I could do this fight like any other time, just roll past his jump, then parry any follow-ups, but chat believed in me. So with a little more encouragement, I did this. Holy shit, I did it. And he's dead. With that, we have linked the fire as the ultimate life form. Hey everyone, thank you so much for watching. Sorry again about any of the used live footage. My options were either use the live footage or redo the whole run, and, well, I didn't want to restart the run. Either way, this was a lot of fun. I mean, it's basically just a hyper mode solo level 1. If you liked what you saw, please consider giving a like and subscribing. It helps me a lot. And drop what challenges you think I should try next in the comments. Thanks again, everybody, and I will see you next time.